Good afternoon, hello and welcome. My name is Radzi and welcome to our very first YouTube live for BBC My World. So if there are any technical problems, we do apologise in advance, but we'll try and rectify them as quickly as we can. If you've never seen BBC My World before, it's essentially a show dedicated to young people right the way around the world, and it talks about the biggest stories and issues that matter to all of you. And what bigger story and issue than the coronavirus pandemic? We're going to be focusing specifically on misinformation, how it spread throughout the world. And to shed an awful lot of light on that, we have a specialist in the area. It's the BBC disinformation reporter, Marianna Spring. Marianna, how are you?
I'm good. How are you?
Very, very well. Now, first of all, I called you a disinformation reporter. Mm-hmm. Is that correct, first of all?
Yes, it is correct.
And what does it even mean?
So what I spend most of my time doing at the moment is looking at dodgy messages on panic or mislead others. Misinformation is slightly more... slightly less deliberate in so much as it's still misleading stuff being shared. It's still going around across social media or the internet, but quite often the people sharing it or the people in some cases even starting it aren't doing so to deliberately cause harm. They end up doing so as a byproduct of that.
Thank you very much for that. And I suppose the big question then is why? When it comes to disinformation, why would people want to spread that?
Well, it varies really, and there are all kinds of different types of people who spread misinformation. So throughout the pandemic, we've been looking at examples of misleading posts and messages on Instagram, TikTok, WhatsApp, and that's given us quite a good idea about the kinds of characters who spread this stuff. There are, for instance, the politicians you might be able to think of who say misleading things, and those claims are then spread on social media or even directly acted on by people who hear them. For instance, Trump last week talking about disinfectant when he suggested that people could perhaps inject disinfectant to help cure coronavirus. Yeah. That's obviously totally false, but there were examples of people calling up helplines because they had done just that, tried to use disinfectant to treat themselves, or of people sharing information and asking questions about this online, and so it begins to spread. But aside from politicians, there are all kinds of other characters. So you've got scammers, people trying to make money or trying to suggest bogus cures and dodgy ways of making yourself feel better. Yes. with lies and fake information. Then you've also got jokers. Sometimes people might, you know, create a funny screenshot on Instagram and don't realise that actually others will believe it to be true, and it causes panic. So there was a fake government text that we looked into. It said that you were going to be fined for leaving your house too many times here in the UK. And the prankster who made that, I interviewed him and he said, oh, I made it because I sort of thought it would be a bit funny to scare people breaking the lockdown. And actually, people then thought it was real and it caused a bit more panic than I perhaps intended it to. So there are a range of different people. And then there's obviously also the people who spread these things, like we were saying, misinformation. So there could be your aunt or your brother or your cousin in a WhatsApp group forward stuff on just in case, or even celebrities who amplify things to thousands and thousands of followers and suggest, for instance, that 5G could cause coronavirus. Right. Or be linked to it. And those claims are totally false, but lots and lots of people see them and more people spread them. So it's about both the sources and the spreaders.
So with that in mind, if I'm looking at my screen, whether it's on my phone or a tablet or a computer, how can I help avoid that?
So we have three golden rules to try and help people stop the spread of misinformation, because like I said, obviously it's really important for governments and regulators and tech companies to get to the bottom of who's behind this stuff, why they're doing it, and to deal with the source. But actually curbing the spread of misinformation is just as helpful and really important in stopping it going further online. So our first rule is always just to stop and think before you share anything. When you see something, just pause for a second. Don't react. Don't just forward it on straight away. Really reflect on what it's about, who's sharing it, whether they have any kind of bias, the reason why they might be sharing it, who might have come up with it in the first place. The second thing we tell people to do is think about how it makes you feel, because generally the kind of misinformation that goes viral is stuff that makes you feel really upset or really angry or even really excited, and it's the accurate information that's actually quite boring. So you should really stop and think about how it makes you feel. And then the other vital thing to do is just to check your source. So we notice with misleading information, it often isn't attributed to anyone, or it is, but it seems to be very vague. So someone who works in a hospital somewhere, or someone's friend's cousin's neighbour who lives next door who sent this on to you. And it can be very easy to get lost in this game of almost Chinese whispers that goes on online. And so it's really crucial to have a look, to check what's going on the official sites that you would turn to, like the World Health Organization, or like the NHS here in the UK, or even looking at other, for instance, the vaccine trials and the kinds of universities and institutions running them, you want to turn to trusted health bodies and institutions for the right information.
So you've shed an awful lot of light on that. Thank you very much for that. We've got questions rather for you at home. I'm going to read those out in just a second, but not before I do ask, when it comes to misinformation, it's not limited to just the global pandemic. This is something which happens in a whole load of different areas.
Yeah, so we see misinformation all the time, particularly in this age of social media. We've seen it during elections, especially often because people are wanting to further political aims or everyone's talking about the same thing online. But this pandemic is unique in so much as everyone across the world is affected by this. So the misinformation we're seeing isn't limited to one particular country, like when there was an election in the UK here before Christmas or the election later this year in the US. Those will be, although other countries may become involved, they largely affect the people in those places. This pandemic affects everyone. So the misinformation is global. It's in a range of different languages. It's on different platforms and it's in different countries. We've seen stuff all over the world in every single continent, basically. There is misleading information about coronavirus and everyone is worried and everyone is affected. And so it can be really easy to help spread this stuff accidentally. And that's why it's so important that people understand what's going on.
Which is exactly what they're doing with their questions, by the way. So thank you for your insight. We've got one from Nock Iona. Now she asks, how do you spot fake news? I asked you how you avoid it, but how can you spot it?
So there are some red flags that we often notice when we look at misleading posts or misleading information. The first one is a bit like one of those top tips I gave, which is check your source. So often misleading posts and messages have those really vague introductions where it seems to be from someone who works at a hospital or a professor or someone's friend's cousin. And what you need to do is try and get to the bottom of who is that person? So Google them, see if you can find the doctor or the institution that's being referenced. You know, look at their website, if it's a specific hospital or university, see if they've put any information up about this. Or ask your friend who sent it to you, where did you get this from? Where did you see it? And more often than not, they'll say, oh, my friend sent it to me and I passed it on. It hasn't come directly from them. Yes. But when information's being forwarded in that way, it can feel really direct, like someone you trust and know is sharing important information with you. There are other red flags as well. So you often can see things like when it's on Facebook or in text format, you often see a mishmash of different fonts or capital letters saying big announcement, please share this on. All those kinds of things are classic red flags that fact checkers look out for when they're trying to monitor stuff. And then, as we said, kind of on that emotional point, but often pictures and images that really evoke a reaction. For instance, really sad ones of, say, I don't know, coffins or where people have been unwell and are incredibly ill. And those pictures can often be misleading, not of the places they say, not showing the things that they say. So you can take it upon yourself, really, to be a bit of a detective. There are loads of tools on the internet that you can use, like reverse image search that allows you to see if a picture was posted a time before. And effectively, we can all become detectives because there's so much misleading information. I can't do it on my own. The team at the BBC can't do it on our own. And to be honest, most governments and other institutions can't really do it on their own either. So it's about each of us being responsible and actually taking it into our own hands to suss out whether something's true or not.
Well, I'm Hannah Chloe, says she wants you to be a detective, essentially, because she says, what was the cause of the virus really, a human eating some type of animal?
So there's a lot of speculation about what caused the virus. And actually, I think it's one of the big issues with coronavirus because people are a bit unclear as to where it came from. It looks as though it possibly came from bats or someone ingesting pangolin in China, in Wuhan, where it began. But it's very difficult to exactly pinpoint what happened and the moment where this virus came to be and mutated and formed. And for that reason, that vacuum of really clear, concrete answers leaves a lot of space for speculation. Yeah. And that's when we see things like conspiracy theories, which we've seen a lot of. So people saying 5G is linked to coronavirus, that's totally false. But, and to be honest, does seem quite bonkers. But you can see why people do believe things like that, because they want an answer, they want to understand where something's come from, and complex answers or a lack of them mean that they turn to conspiracy theories or other kind of you know, possible options. People say, oh, it was made in the lab in the US, or it was invented in China, or all of these various kind of conspiracy theories that are bashed around on the internet. And it's really important that people understand that this is complicated and we don't have all the answers yet. And we can look for the answers, but we also have to accept that we're not going to have clear answers about coronavirus, perhaps for some months, particularly about cures, about vaccines, or even about the exact cause, the exact time frame. And we're just going to have to sit with that and accept that there are some things we know and some things we don't know yet, but not try and fill that gap with false claims.
We don't know about cures, we don't know about vaccines yet, mm-hmm. but another question is it correct that once somebody is immune, or rather, once somebody contracts it, they'll be immune for their entire life?
So there's been a lot of conversation about whether contracting coronavirus means that you're immune to it. Again, it's something that we've seen quite a lot on social media, people copy and pasting messages where they say, oh, my friend told me that actually someone's had coronavirus 6 times or 7 times or things like that. Generally, when it comes to viruses, you'd expect that you would have the virus and you develop antibodies that would protect you from that particular strain of that virus. But as I just said, with coronavirus, we don't have all the answers yet. And we kind of have to accept that we don't know for certain that people are better protected once they've had it. We would presume that maybe they would be. And that's why a vaccine would work in protecting you against coronavirus. But we just can't know the exact answers until scientists have had the time to be able to figure out all of those answers, and they're working really, really hard to do that. And it doesn't help if we try and fill in the gaps and say, oh, I know for definite this or for definite that. We have to accept that sometimes those answers aren't so clear cut.
Well, somebody who tried to come up with one of his own answers was the President Donald Trump, and with that in mind, we've got a question from Flora Raybould, who says, what's been the reaction online after Trump's statement about injecting disinfectant?
So that obviously sparked a lot of controversy, both from the press and from people on social media. And actually, most of the stuff I saw on social media was people saying, oh my gosh, this is mad. Why has he said this? Trump obviously later said my comments were sarcastic, but that didn't stop people taking action on what he said. So trying to use disinfectant to treat themselves and calling up helplines and ending up ill. And that's the really dangerous impact of misinformation, because it's not just limited to your phone or your computer. It affects people in real life. And we'd seen a lot of the things about disinfectant, or particularly he claims that UV light could perhaps be used to cure coronavirus. And that's a claim we've seen going around on Facebook, on Instagram for quite a while now. The thing is, and it's what he did when he spoke about this, and it's what we see with misinformation all the time, is he took things that are true. Disinfectant does kill viruses and germs and bugs when they're on a surface and you wipe down that surface. But that doesn't mean that if you drink some disinfectant, it's going to kill the virus inside you. Disinfectant is hazardous. It's poisonous. You shouldn't ingest it or consume it in any way like that. And you shouldn't be trying to inject it into yourself. But about disinfectant or the UV light stuff, the weather or that kind of thing. But again, there's a lack of scientific evidence to support these claims, and often true facts are taken out of context and put into a new kind of framework which points people to the wrong conclusions. And that's what happened with Trump.
And that's part of the problem, I suppose, of knowing a headline of a story but not necessarily reading the entire article. So you've got a flavour of something, a bit of a truth, the mind wanders, and that's where it becomes a bit of a mistruth.
Exactly. And the age of social media means we're really used to immediate stuff. Like, we all sit on our phones, flick through Instagram, look at our Instagram stories, we get something really quickly and we think, oh yeah, interesting, gonna keep going. And we don't actually get into the subject matter. And with coronavirus, the answers aren't simple and they aren't straightforward, or they don't sometimes exist. And so people will have to really engage with what's being said to them and be willing to accept that all of how you can't just take headline numbers and compare them between countries. You need to make sure that you're looking at numbers that reflect the same things, that they show all of the people who have died, or as many people as you know have died, or they just show hospitals, or they show others affected. And again, often people, when it comes to deaths and stuff, it's really scary for people, and it's emotive and you react. Yes. So you might see some information that says, oh, someone who was only 14 died of coronavirus, and that's incredibly sad and really worrying, and young people can be really badly affected by coronavirus. But if that statistic is pulled out and taken into context with regards to the number of people who do actually die, you can get a bit more perspective on how likely it is, or how unlucky or sad that was. And you sometimes need to do that. You need to pause for a second, particularly when it comes to deaths and information about them, and really look at what the number represents, what it means, what it looks like in context. And on the BBC website, we've got loads of different ways of kind of measuring numbers and looking at charts. We do some really good simple charts that compare the same kinds of figures and that you can use to help you better understand what's going on and how different countries and places are affected.
There's another very specific question. It's kind of along the same lines. It says, why a person who dies and hasn't been tested can still be regarded as having died from COVID-19?
So again, this is another big issue. Some countries have been testing people a lot more than others. They've had the capacity to or been prepared to. Other countries haven't done that. And so it means that we don't always know if someone has died of coronavirus. We might suspect that they showed the symptoms, or alternatively, someone might have been in hospital for another reason and ill for another reason, but they end up contracting coronavirus and dying. And again, this is the kind of thing that's not going to become too clear until A, we can test more people in different places, and there are certain countries where that's a real concern, and B, until after the event has passed and we're able to really work out who has directly died from this, who has died from complications as a result of coronavirus. It's just not so straightforward, and we all look for that headline number and are almost looking for, oh God, which country's worse affected? And I think a lot of the reporting about coronavirus towards the beginning was about, oh, how many people have died of coronavirus in this country compared to this country, and who's suffering worst. And you saw a lot of that on social media and a lot of people comparing, oh, Italy says this and this and it's been terrible in Italy, we should learn from this. But it's really important, as we said, to just take a step back to work out what numbers represent, what they could include, and to accept that they might not reflect the entire picture yet, but they will too.
And in terms of the entire picture, you often hear journalists mixing between saying X number of people have died with coronavirus, mm-hmm. and sometimes have died from coronavirus. Mm-hmm. What would you make of the distinction between those two?
So I think the reason that there's a distinction between those two is because some people will contract coronavirus who otherwise have been getting on with their lives quite healthily and happily, and they end up dying of coronavirus, and it's quite obvious that they have died as a direct consequence of contracting that disease. But then there are people who might be suffering from other complications, who might be in hospital having a different operation, or who might have not been very well, or might have been suffering from a chronic disease otherwise that made them very ill. They might have cancer, they might have some kind of other medical problem. And they might contract coronavirus and die, but they've suffered so badly and because they already were ill in some kind of form. So it's difficult to distinguish between, you know, it's not so simple. Lots of human beings have different health problems and different things that they know about or maybe don't know about. And so working out what exactly has resulted in them dying is difficult for doctors, particularly when they're overrun with lots of people who are very ill and dying.
And this final question, I suppose, for me personally, if I was sat at home watching this now, people are feeling overwhelmed. There's mm-hmm. a lot of information. Some of it's true. Some of it, as we've spoken about, isn't quite so true. What would you say to people who are perhaps at home feeling quite scared now?
I think that it's crucial that there are loads of really good places that you can get information that's helpful, that is clear, all kinds of BBC places you can turn, like My World, like BBC Bite Size, we have a disinformation team and we investigate misleading stuff. So if you see something dodgy, you can hopefully search it and it will be on the BBC Live page, or we do stories talking about this. Things like BBC Minute, which is great. It's an Instagram for younger people that people can follow. And it does all kinds of things talking about issues people might be facing during coronavirus, mental health, issues to do with their love life and trying to date people, all kinds of different problems that people are experiencing. And I think it's crucial not to consume too much. And one thing that I often find when talking about misinformation is older people can often be more likely to fall foul to misleading stuff because they're not so used to using social media. But it's younger people who are more exposed to it. And we might not be so likely to believe it or be susceptible to it. We'll see something on Instagram and think, oh God, that's rubbish. But we consume so much of it that it can really exhaust us and really overwhelm us. And so it's crucial just to make sure that you're not spending too much time on your phone. And for us, news isn't just on apps. It's not just on the BBC News app or on Twitter. It's on Instagram. A celebrity can talk about 5G and coronavirus, nice. Falsely linking the two. And you see that when you're also looking at pictures of your friend cooking banana bread at home or other stuff like that. So it's crucial just to remember that all social media exposes us to what's going on at the moment because it's part of everyone's lives, and you need to take a moment to both pause for yourself and pause to make sure you're not sharing things that could be misleading or unhelpful to other people.
Marianna, that's been absolutely fascinating. Thank you very much for your time and thank you for your insight. And remember, BBC